कर दूँ। हेलो ऑल, टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट दी लॉ एंड दी लॉ लैंग्वेज एंड दी लॉ। सो गुड इवनिंग डियर स्टूडेंट फॉर सेमिस्टर वन। आई एम कंडक्टिंग दिस रिविजन लेक्चर फॉर द बेनिफिट एंड इंटरेस्ट ऑफ आवर स्टूडेंट। सो एज फॉर दिस टू टच ऑन दी लैंग्वेज एंड दी लॉ, India, like the United States, is a secular nation. Whereas India, unlike the United States, does not define secular as being separate from or without any religious or spiritual basis. Under the Constitution, all religion are treated are equal and protected from discrimination. Historically, religion has played a key role in maintaining governments within India. Within ancient Hindu society, political consolidation was most effectively accomplished when paired with religious reinforcement. Many political conflicts within India were also religious wars, and the physical protection of both religious places and princes became a necessary task and sometimes provided by the state. So this history is not unique to India, as many European nations have had a political system that is highly dependent on religion. So what is the unique is the role religion plays in political today, that India is one of the largest and most populous countries of the world. With the population of over 1.2 billion people, it boasts the sixth largest economy in the world by nominal GDP, and the third largest by purchasing power parities. So India is home to several languages, the majority of which belongs to the Indo-Aryan and Dravidian families. India is the country's official and most commonly spoken language, whereas other common languages include Bengali, Telugu, Marathi and Tamil. Apart from the 22 scheduled languages which are given official recognitions, India Constitution has recognized 6 languages collectively known as classical languages because of their rich heritage and independence. For a language to be considered classical, its record must date back to as many as 1500 to 2000 years. It must also be rich in heritage and must be original and not borrowed from any other community. So what is the relationship between language and law? A law is a standard which is essential for maintaining peace and order in systematic form of society. So the language is a rule-based system of sign used for communication. Laws, code in language and legal concepts are accessible only through languages. Article 8, Draft Constitution 1948, where in this article the expression of law includes any ordinance, order, bylaw, rules, regulations, notifications, customs or usages having the force of law in the territory of India or any part of thereof. Whereas law inconsistent with or in derogations of the fundamental right, all laws in force in the territory of India immediately before the commencement of the Constitution, insofar as they are inconsistent with the provisions of parts, shall to the extent of such inconsistency be void. So the state shall not make any law which takes away or abrides the rights conferred by this part or any law made in contravention of this particular clause. To the extent of the contravention being void, Article 13 in the Constitution says that law includes any ordinance, order, bylaw, rules, regulation, notification, customs or usages having in the territory of India the force of law. So the laws in force includes laws passed or made by legislature or other competent authority in the territory of India before the commencement of the Constitution and not previously repealed. That notwithstanding that any such law or any part thereof may not be then in operation either or at all or in any particular area. So whereas Article 13 clause 4 says nothing in this article shall apply to any amendment of the Constitution made under Article 368. Now then, why is language important in a law? So words are the essential tools of the law, and in the study of law, language has great importance. Like cases turns on the meaning that judges ascribe to words, and lawyers must use the right words to effectuate the wishes of their client. What Indian Constitution says about language, that Article 343(1) of the Indian Constitution specifically mentions that the official language of the Union shall be Hindi in Devanagari script. The problem of legal language in India is of lingua franca, because in lingua franca in India is important because of language's basics. And according to the People Linguistic Survey of India, there are 780 languages and 86 scriptures, out of which 250 languages extinguished and some other languages are in endanger. Then what are the two most important which is officially languages in India? So after overview that India does not have a national language. However, that rule 1976 as amendment in 1987 of the Constitution of India, which mandates Hindi and English as the official languages, which required for official purpose of the Union. Businesses in the Indian Parliament is transcribed in either Hindi or in English. The official language of India are Hindi and English. So an official language is a language given a special status in the particular country, state or other jurisdiction. But then what the history of language in India? The history is said that the Indo-Aryan languages which developed and emerged in three stages. First stage is Old Indo-Aryan, that was 1500 BCE to 600 BCE. Middle Indo-Aryan stage, which is 600 BCE and 1000 CE, and New Indo-Aryan between 1000 CE and 1300 CE. CE means the common era, and BCE means the before the common era. The modern North Indian Indo-Aryan languages, which are evolved into distinct recognizable languages in the New Indo-Aryan ages. If you go back during this period, that 1500 BCE, we have to study that the oldest language in India. So that the Prakrit and Pali, the Prakrits are the oldest language, whereas Pali is an advanced version of that, which modify language using various Prakrits of the north as base languages. Later on that, we see that emerging new language known as Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit that had Pratik and Pali grammatical base, but the words are sound change. Then Sanskrit is believed that all the languages of the world has originated from Sanskrit somewhere. The Sanskrit language has been spoken since 500 years before Christ, and Sanskrit is still the official language of India. This is the second oldest language in the world, which is still being used today. So Sanskrit is the language of Jainism, Hinduism, in school and colleges one of the optional subject is Sanskrit. Even ICSE board is also Sanskrit, Marathi, French is the optional subject where the student can choose any one of that subject. Vedic Sanskrit is the language of the Vedas. A large collection of hymns, incantations and religion philosophical discussions which formed the earliest religious text in India and the basis for much of the Hindu religion. So the modern linguist consider the metrical hymns of the Rig Veda to be the earliest. The hymns preserved in the Rig Veda were preserved by oral traditions, alone over several centuries before the introductions of writing. But the end of the Vedic period is marked by the composition of the Upanishad, which forms the concluding part of the Vedic corpus in the traditional compilations, and it's dated to roughly around 500 BCE. It is around this time that Sanskrit began the traditions from a first language to a second language of religion and learning, marking the beginning of classical India. Then Prakrit is the modern scholar has used the term Prakrit into two concepts. Prakrit language is a group of closely related literary languages, whereas the second is Prakrit is the one of the languages which alone was used as the primary language of entire, the poem and the some old stories. The broadest definition used the term Prakrit to describe many Middle Indo-Aryan language that deviates from Sanskrit in any manner. Prakrit meaning is original, natural, normal, or the ordinary usual, is the broad family of Indo-Aryan languages are dialects spoken in ancient India. Some modern scholars includes all Middle Indo-Aryan languages under the rubric of Prakrits, while others emphasize the independent development of these languages, often separated from the history of Sanskrit, which like by wide divisions of caste, religions, and geography. The Prakrit became literary languages generally patronized by kings identified with the Kshatriya caste. This is one of the caste, and the earliest inscriptions in Prakrit are those of Ashoka, emperor of the Mauryan Empire. And while the various Prakrit languages are associated with different patron dynasties, with different religions and different literary traditions. So in Sanskrit, the drama, kings speak in Prakrit when addressing women or servants. In contrast to the Sanskrit used in reciting more formal poetic, monologues. So the three dramatic Prakrit like Saurashini, then Magadhi, then Maharashtri, as well as the Jain Prakrit, each represent a distinct traditions of literature within the history of India. Other Prakrit are reported in historical sources, but has no extant corpus. There is one of Paisasi for regarding this, no extant of corpus. The Prakrit and the Pali is the Middle Indo-Aryan language in which the Theravada Buddhist scriptures and commentaries are preserved. Pali is believed by the Theravada, this is the traditions, to be the same language as Magadhi. But modern scholars believe this to be unlikely. Pali shows that signs of development from several underlying Prakrits as well as some of the Sanskritization. So the Prakrit of the northwestern area of India, known as Gandhara, and has come to be called Gandhari. So a few documents are written in the Kharoshi script. This is the script, name of the script, which survive, including a version of the Dhammapada. So the Prakrit, which includes Pali, were gradually transformed into Upper Brahmas, which were used until around the 13th century common era. And the term this Upper Brahmsa, meaning fallen, referred to the dialects of northern India before the rise of modern northern Indian languages, and implies a correct or non-standard language. A significant amount of Upper Brahmasa literature has been found in Jain libraries. While Amir Khushro and Kabir were writing in a language quite similar to modern Hindi and Urdu, many poets, and especially in regions that were still ruled by Hindu kings, continued to write in Upper Brahmasa. Whereas Hindustani is right now the most spoken language in the Indian subcontinent and the fourth most spoken language in the world. The development of Hindustani revolves around the various Hindi dialects originating mainly from Saurseni and Upper Brahms. Modern Hindi is based on the prestigious Kariboli dialects, which started to take Persian and Arabic words too with the establishment of the Hindi Sultans. However, the Arabic Persian influence was profound mainly on Urdu and to a lesser extent on Hindi. And Kadi Boli also started to spread across North India as a vernacular from previously commonly known as Hindustani. During the Bhakti era, that many poems, you know, were composed in Kadi Boli, then Braj Bhasha and the Avadhi. So one such classic is Dharmacharitmas, written by Tulsidas in Avadhi. The establishment of British rule is the subcontinent which saw the clear divisions of Hindi and Urdu registers. So this period also saw that rise of modern Hindi literature, starting with Bharatendu, Harishchandra, and this period also shows further Sanskritization of the Hindi language in literature. Hindi is right now the official language in 9 states of India: Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand, Haryana and Himachal Pradesh. And the national capital territory of Delhi, that includes all the state. Post independence, Hindi became the official language of the central government of India along with English, and Urdu has been the national and official language of Pakistan as well as the lingua franca of the country. The meaning of lingua franca is a language that is adopted as a common language between speakers whose native languages are different. A mixture of, you know, like Italian with French, Greeks, Arabic and Spanish, formerly used in the Eastern Mediterranean. Outside the India, Hindustani is widely understood in other parts of the Indian subcontinent and also as a lingua franca, and is the main language of Bollywood. So even the Marathi is one of the several languages that furthers descent from Maharishi Pratik, and further change lead to the Abhapramasa language. So like further that will be changed, but however this is the challenge by Bloch in the year 1970, where who started that Abhapramasa was the form after Marathi had already separated from the Middle Indian dialect. The earliest example of Maharishi as a separate language, which dated to approximately 3rd century BC, a stone's inscriptions found in a cave at Nanighat, Junar in Pune district, has been written in Maharishi using Brahmi script. So a committee appointed by the Maharashtra state government to get the classical status for Marathi has claimed that Marathi existed at least 2300 years ago, along with Sanskrit and Prakrit as a like sister language. मराठी अ डेरिवेटिव ऑफ महाराष्ट्री इज प्रोबेबली फर्स्ट अटेस्टेड इन द 739 CE इन द कॉपर प्लेट इंस्क्रिप्शन फाउंड इन सातारा आफ्टर 1187 CE. And the use of Marathi, which grew substantially in the inscriptions of the Sivana, Yadava kings, who earlier used Kannada and Sanskrit in their inscription. So the Marathi became the dominant language of epigraphy during the last half century of the dynasty rule, 14th century. Marathi gained prominence with the rise of Maratha Empire, the beginning of the regime of Shivaji, 1630 to 1680, and during his period the language used in administrative documents became less personalized, whereas in 1630, 80% of the vocabulary was Persian. It's dropped to 37% by 1677. The British colonial period, starting in early 1800, is standardization of Marathi grammars. Through the efforts of the Christian missionaries, that is William Carey, and according to that the Carey dictionary had fewer entries and Marathi words were in Devanagari. So the translation of the Bible were first books to be printed in Marathi, and these translations by William Carey, the American Marathi missions and the Scottish missionaries lead to the development of the peculiar paganized Marathi called missionary Marathi in the early 1800s. After Indian independence, after Indian independence, Marathi was accorded the status of a scheduled language on the national level. In 1956, the Bombay States was reorganized, which brought mostly Marathi and Gujarati speaking areas under one state. So the further reorganizations of the Bombay state, which on 1st May 1960 created the Marathi speaking Maharashtra and Gujarati speaking Gujarat state respectively. With the state and cultural protections, Marathi made great strides by the 1990s. According to some scholars, such as German scholars, Richard Pichfield is one of the good scholar in this. He explained the term of Prakrit referred to a smaller set of language that were used exclusively in literature. But then again the question is, who invented Hindi language in India? So the answer, like other Indo-Aryan languages, Hindi is the direct descendant of an early form of Vedic Sanskrit, which emerged in the 7th century CE. Then which is the 5 oldest language, because basically the question somewhere asked, it is very important to know that which 5 or 3 languages in India, oldest language. So the old Indo-Arya is the one. Sanskrit, if we say Sanskrit, so again there is a Sanskrit division of two, like Vedic Sanskrit or the classical Sanskrit. Prakriti is also there. Then after that, Hindustani, Marathi, Old Tamil, Middle Tamil, Kannada, they all are during this rate. Now, but the language of India are divided into various languages, which is family of which the Indo-Aryan. Indo-Aryan and the Dravidian. So the Indo-Aryan and the Dravidian languages are the most widely spoken together, known as Indic language. Known as Indic languages. So there are also many languages belonging to the unrelated language families, such as Austro-Asiatic and Sino-Tibetan, because spoken by smaller group, a smaller community. Linguistic records begin with the appearance of the Gujarati from about the 3rd century BCE, before the Common Era. The Dravidian family of languages include approximately 73 languages, and that are mainly spoken in southern India and in northeast, like Sri Lanka, and as well as certain areas in Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, and also eastern and central India, as well in the part of the southern Afghanistan, and overseas in other countries such as the United Kingdom, United States, Canada, Malaysia, and Singapore. The origins of the Dravidian languages, as well as their subsequent development and the period of their differentiation, are unclear, and the situation is not helped by the lack of comparative linguistic research into the Dravidian languages. Like many linguists, however, trying to favor the theory that speaker of Dravidian languages, which spread southwards and the eastward and the through the Indian subcontinent, based on the fact that the southern Dravidian languages show some sign of contact with linguistic groups which the northern Dravidian language do not. So the Proto-Dravidian is thought to have differentiated into Proto-North Dravidian, that Proto-Central Dravidian and Proto-South Dravidian, around 1500 BCE. In 1856, one of the English authors, that Robert Calvert, which published book regarding comparative grammar of the Dravidian or South Indian family of languages, which considerably expanded the Dravidian umbrella and established it as one of the major language groups of the world. And according to him, Dravidian from the Sanskrit Dravida, and which related to Tamil, or we can say the Tamilian, where the language of India is a primary, is a two major linguistic family, the Indo-European as well as the Dravidian. Indo-European includes Indo-Aryan is spoken by about 75% of the population, and Dravidian spoken by about 25%. Other languages spoken in India come mainly from the Austroasiatic and Tibetan Brahman linguistic families, as well as a few languages which isolates. So individual mother tongue in India numbers several hundreds, and you know, more than a thousand if major dialects are included. Around 400 languages for India. 24 of these languages are spoken by more than a million native speakers, and 114 by more than 10,000. So the three millenaries, that the three millennia of this all political and social contact, which have resulted in mutual influence among the fourth language families in India and South Asia. Two contact languages have played an important role in the history of India, and that is for the Persian and English. While Hindi is the official language of the central government in India, with English as a provisional official sub-language, like includes state legislatures can adopt any religion or the region's language as the official language of that state. And the Constitution of India recognized 23 official languages spoken in different parts of the country, and two official classical language. Classical language, when they call it, immediately the Sanskrit and the Tamil name comes, and it's called a classical language. But the officially language, and because India has officially languages at the state and the central level, but there is no one national language. Hindi is the official language of the central government in India, with English as the provisional official sub-language. Individual state literatures can adopt any regional language as the official language of that state. So the Article 346 of the Indian Constitution recognizes Hindi in Devanagari script. Hindi is a Devanagari script as the official language of central government of India. And the Constitution also allows for the continuation of use of the English language for officially purpose. So the Article 345 provides constitutional recognition as official languages of the Union to any language adopted by a state legislature as the officially language of that state. And until the 21st Amendment of the Constitution 1967, the country recognized 14 official regional languages. The 8th schedule and the 71st amendment provided for the inclusion of Sindhi, Konkani, Manipuri and Nepali, increasing the number of official regional language of India to 18. Individual states whose border are mostly drawn a sociolinguistic lines are free to decide their own languages for internal administration and education. In 2004, the government elevated Tamil to the newly created official status of classical language, followed by Sanskrit in 2005. And the Indian Constitution, the Constitution of India, recognized 23 official languages spoken in different parts of the country. And this consists of English plus 22 Indian languages, Assami, Bengali, Dogri, Gujarati, Hindi, Bodo, Kannada, Kashmiri, Kokni, Maithili, Malayalam, Marathi also, Nepali, Odisha, Punjabi, Sanskrit, Tamil Nadu, Urdu, and 2-3 more. So Hindi is an official language of the state of Uttar Pradesh. Bihar, Jharkhand, Uttarakhand, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Himachal Pradesh, Haryana, and the national capital, territory of Delhi. There, Hindi is an official language of that state. Pondicherry and Andaman Nicobar Island also included there. But the Tamil is an official language of Tamil Nadu, whereas Pondicherry and Andaman Nicobar Island is also somewhere this affects. So the English is the co-official language of the Indian Union, and each of the several states may also have another co-official language. And the 22 Indian languages set out in the 8th schedule in the period of 2007 in Indian Constitution, like Assami people speak Assami, Bengali people speak Bengal, West Bengal, or somewhere like Bangla people also Tripura, Andaman, they like places is also covered, like Assami is Assam covered, Bengali and Bengalis are covered, Andaman Nicobar Island as well as Tripura, West Bengal. Bodo is also covered up Assam. Dogri is Jammu and Kashmir. Gujarati, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman, Diu and Gujarat. So the places and the name, like if we said Hindi, so Hindi, Andaman Nicobar Island, then Arunachal Pradesh, Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Chandigarh, the national capital, the territory of Delhi, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, okay. Kannada, like Karnataka, Kashmiri, Jammu and Kashmir, Kokni, Karnataka and Goa, Marathi, of course for the Dagra and Nagar Haveli, Daman, Diu, Goa, and of course for the Maharashtra. So the places and the area is, it's depend. Like if I'm speaking Marathi because of the, my states. Punjabi, Chhattisgarh, Delhi, Haryana, Punjab, the same. Like Sindhi is in the community. Telugu, Andhra Pradesh. So the English and Hindi and in Indian Constitution declares Hindi in Devanagari script to be the official language of the Union. Unless Parliament decided otherwise, the use of English for official purposes, because of officially to cease after the Constitution came into effect on January 26, 1965. The prospect of the change overlaid too much alarm in the non-Hindi speaking area of India, and as a result of which Parliament enacted the, because of that, Officially Language Act in 1963, and providing for the continued use of English for officially purposes along with Hindi. Even after 1965, So an attempt was made in late 1964 to expressly provide for an end to the use of English, but it was met with protest from across the country, some of which turned violent. Widespread protest occur in states such as, you know, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, West Bengal, Karnataka, Pondicherry and Andhra Pradesh. And because of that, as a result of this protest, the proposal was dropped and the act itself was amended in 1967 to provide that the use of English would not be ended until a resolution to that effect was passed by the legislature of every state that had not adopted Hindi as its official language, and by each houses of Indian Parliament. Languages of other families in India, like I told earlier that Sino-Tibetan language are spoken in the western Himalayas, and here Himachal Pradesh and in the, you know, highland of northeast India. The Sino-Tibetan family includes such languages as Methi, Tripuri, Bodo, Naga and Gora. And some of the languages traditionally includes in Sino-Tibetan may actually be language isolates or part of small independent language families. The Austroasiatic family spoken in east and north northeast India. So Austroasiatic language, which include the Santhal and Munda language of eastern India, covered Nepal, Bangladesh and the, you know, Monkhamer language spoken by the Kashi and Nicobars in India, and in Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam and in southern China, the Austroasiatic language, which arrived in East India around 4000 to 3500 ago from Southern East Asia, or Southeast Asia. So the great Andamanese and Organs language is also there. On the Andamans island, language from at least two families have spoken the great Andamanese language and the Ongan language, and the Sentinel language is spoken on North Sentinel island, but the contact had not been made with the Sentinelese. Its language affiliation is unknown. Joseph Greenberg, a person, considered the great Andamanese language to be a part of a larger Indo-Pacific family. It was not established through the comparative method, but considered superior by historical linguists. Nehali language called isolates, is a language isolate spoken in Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. Affiliation has been suggested to the Munda language, but they have yet to be demonstrated. But the families of languages also some is different, you know, like the language of India may be grouped by major language families, and the largest of these families in terms of speaker is the Indo-European family, and predominantly represented in its Indo-Aryan branch. According for some 700 million speakers, but also including minority language such as, you know, Persian, Portuguese or French and English speaking as lingua franca. The second largest is the Dravidian family. According or the counting for some 200 million speakers. So the minor linguistic families include the Munda with approximately 9 million speakers and Tibetan Burman families with approximately 6 million speakers are there. And there is also a language isolate, the Nihali language. History of language in India, when we consider, then we have to go South Asia. Because language family in South Asia, the Northern Indian languages from the Kalestini family, which evolved from old Indo-Aryan, such as Sanskrit, by way of the Middle Indo-Aryan, and Prakrit language as well as the Upper Brahmsa of the Middle East. There is no census of this or on this specific time when the modern North Indian languages such as Hindi, Marathi, Punjabi and Bengali emerge. But 1000 CE is commonly accepted. The development of each language was influenced by social and political contact with foreign invaders and speaker of the other languages. Hindi or we can say Urdu are closely related languages, were strongly influenced by Persian and Arabic. The South Indian Dravidian language has a history dependent of Sanskrit, and the origins of the Dravidian language as well as their subsequent development and the period of their, you know, differentiation are unclear. And educate comparative linguistics. Research into the Dravidian languages is lacking. Because in inconclusive attempt which has been made to link the family with the Japonic language, then the Korean, then Sumerian, the Australian original languages and the unknown languages of the Indus Valley civilization. However, in later states, all the Dravidian languages were heavily influenced by Sanskrit. And the major Dravidian languages are Telugu, Tamil, Kannada and Malayalam. Bengali arose from the Eastern Middle Indic languages of the Indian subcontinent. The Bihari languages, the Oriya language, the Bengali Assami language. Here some argument or the argue for much earlier point of divergence, because going back to as early as 500 CE, but the language was not static. Different varieties coexisted and authors often wrote in multiple dialects. And according to Greenberg author, he said the Assamese languages of the Andaman Island and the Nihali language of Central India are thought to be Indo-Pacific languages related to the Pona language of New Guinea, and it is related to somewhere in Halmeria and the New Britain. Nihali has been shown to be related to Kusunda of central Nepal, and Nihali and Kusunda are spoken by hunting people living in forest. But the root of the language, the majority of the components that makes up the Indian language belong to the Indo-Aryan or the Dravidian language families. And the former is a subdivision of the Indo-European language family and is spoken by 70% of the Indians, mostly in North India, while the Dravidian languages are only spoken by 22% of the population. And are predominant in the south. So the other Indian languages are from the Austroasiatic or the Sino-Tibetan linguistic families, and there are a few languages isolated as well as the Nihali and the Kolto language. Like if we consider Dravidian, so Dravidian has a four part: north, central, south central and the south one. So the north is there, then the Kurukoria and the Malto is the one, central Kolani and the Kond, and south area Gond, Khoya, Telugu is there, and the only south is for the Kannada, Tamil and Telugu. So Dravidian divided into four places, where the same is Indo-Aryan, the western, central, eastern and the northwest. Influence of foreign language in India is also is one of the factor. Like India has been home to several great empires which brought many centuries of peace to the land. The Indian subcontinent has endured many conquests throughout its history. Certainly the one with the longest lasting effect was the Aryan invasion, which brought Vedic speech with it, and Sanskrit, Prakrit and Sorani is they are the several as language of inter-regional communication from early times until the Muslim invasion in North India in the 13th century. At this time, Persian became the court language, while Apabhramsa continued to be used as an official language. And beginning with the Mughal emperor, that the Akbar regents, Persian was used as the official language, and over time gained such prestige that it enjoy continue use as the official language in North India even after the end of the Muslim rule. However, during the 17th and the 18th century, India and Urdu also developed into languages of inter-regional communication. The last foreign language that to hold sway in India, that is English, which is the third continue to play a important role, prominent role in India, Indian lives. English replaced Persian as the official language in 1837. Through Persian and to a lesser extent, Hindi was retained in some capacity at the lower levels of administration. So the English also became the language of the intellectual elite, a situation which has been replicated in many parts of the post-colonial world. And today, English is spoken by approximately 3 to 4% of the Indian population. Although this is a minority, it is perhaps the most light and influential minority in India today. But after independence, choosing the new national language is one of the factors. So the after gain independence from the British in 1947, the leaders of the new Indian nation recognized the opportunity to unite the many regions of India with the common universal language. And five requirements are put of any language to be accepted as the national language. So the first is should be easy to learn for government official. It should be capable of serving as a medium of religious, economic, political intercourse throughout India. It should be easy to learn for the whole of the country. It should be the speech of the majority of the inhabitant of India. And this language must be considerations of temporary or passing interest should not count. So the task of Indian government was an important here, but difficult one, not only because choosing the Ling language was a controversial task. Also here, because it would be, you know, difficult to get the public to accept any particular language, and though it did not have an assured dominance over the other languages in India, Hindi seems the clearest choice for the beginning. And English, despite its prominence and somewhat even distribution throughout the nations, was unacceptable for several reasons. So the English also had few speakers. Only about 1% of India population, and Hindi claimed the greatest number of speakers of all the Indian languages, and it was closely related to several of the most widely spoken one. So though it was unrelated to the South Indian language, it was also thought that India would not be entirely foreign to South Indians because of the strong Sanskrit influence and its share with the four main Dravidian languages. Whether or not this thinking correct, don't know, but the Hindi was chosen as the official language, which amazed in the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru assurance that it would never be imposed on people in non-Hindi areas. Nowadays also we can see it's a promotion of Hindi or somewhere, you know, the factor which working against its success, that don't know exactly. But yes, the Constitution of India was framed with the provisions that the languages, that the official language of the Union would be Hindi in Devanagari script with international numerals. So the many actions were taken to lay the ascendancy of Hindi, the government which funded association which promoted Hindi throughout India, the most successful of which were organization which provided Hindi instruction in the South. And even though Hindi was perhaps the most natural choices, there were many blocks opposed to its achieving success as the national language. And one of these was the high position of English, a position it has, you know, retained until today despite the plan to phase it out of all government communications by 1965. And the desire to have an Indian language which replaced English was actually part of nationalist thinking. Somewhere it's called it's a nationalist thinking since 1920. Like the study of English which continue with even greater, you know, vigor than before, or whereas Hindi suffer in many regions where people perceive little need for it. This, like a large section of the educated population who went into government services, needed to use English in performing their job. And accordingly that English has merely shared its position as an official language with Hindi rather than relinquishing the role entirely. Where English has acted as a stumbling block for Hindi, the other major Indian languages has provided a wall. And according to the Indian, English is, you know, fine as an official language, but it could never be a national language. The major Indian languages are all highly developed and, you know, have impressive literacy traditions of their own. Even so, it is not more than just a matter of psychological resentment. But for a while, this, you know, evaluations of one language to the status of official language, which endow great benefit and advancement, advantages on the those whose mother tongue it is. So it is also a place of discriminatory, you know, burdens on others. Certainly, the conditions has helped English keep its place in India. Some were also faced difficulty with against the imposition of Hindi because of this and other factors. Because working against the promotions of Hindi or neither the plan changeover from English to Hindi as the official language nor the envisions rise of Hindi as the national language, which, you know, occurred. In 1965, in accordance with the 15-year plan, which instructions were given to go ahead with the linguistics changeover, communication between the central and the state was to be in Hindi, except for the non-Hindi states. Of course, the opposition is also came in 1965 because a resolution was passed by the Congress Working Committee and we stated that the position of English as an official language would not change unless all states consented to it. But the language issues loses prominence. The language issue is recent year, you know, like has attracted much less attention than it previously did because the India-Pakistan war in 1965 pushed the language issue to the background or the background for only a short while. But the Second World War with Pakistan in 1971, which compounded these effects. So the population explosion which began in the 1970 has become one of the foremost problem in India up to the present, you know, days also somewhere. So the national language or the official language. So before entering this year, just like, you know, it is distinction between national as language as well as the official. So it's quite, you know, simply because a national language is that which enjoy use throughout an entire nation in the political, social and cultural realms. It also function as a national symbol. An official language is one which is used for the operation for the government. In a world, national languages are symbolic and official languages are pragmatic. So it is not uncommon for a national language to also be an official language, but it is less likely that an official language will be national one as well. Basically, two terms somewhere interchangeably here, you know, like in reference to the status of Hindi thus far as in the earlier one. So this is like the ambiguity which India itself seems to have about whether Hindi is a national language or the official language or both. But the technically, according to the Constitution of India, Hindi is only the official language. Actuality, it's seems that Indian leader at that time of independence thought of India more as the national language. If the framer of the Constitution of India took care of this, all these things, so officially language, the status of this category has not, you know, like, it's a good deal of somewhere confusion that we persisted from the very first demands for national language during the early phase of, you know, nationalist struggle. The lack of appreciation of this complexity governing, like, you know, there are even the confusions, then you know that multilingual society can be descends in the speeches and writing of the leaders and the intellectual during this phase of Indian nationalism. Some might argue that even though it is not officially recognized as the national language, Hindi does enjoy that status. After all, it is the most widely spoken language in India with the most geographically diverse population of speakers. However, this cannot change the fact that the vast region of India have little or no knowledge of Hindi, and some are quite opposed to it. But then again, question came before us that why Hindi has failed to become the national language. Because this language issue simply cannot be blamed on the politicians alone. We the society, even it's our duty to protect for the regarding the language. One thing has caused greater division within India than votes seeking politicians could ever have done. The fact that Hindi was imposed on regions which did not speak it. And the only blame here lies with the brass promoters of Hindi, who were more interested in forcing this area to learn Hindi than with allowing them to gradually accept it first. Organize the Hindi language program such as Hindi Sahitya Sammelan, and even the government of India organized that Hindi Pakwada is like 1 or 2 week the period. I could not record them exact. In this period, if you are take a participate for that program, you will get a prize like 10,000, 25,000, something is there that organized by government of India. Every year that 1 week of Pakwada, Hindi Pakwada, they called Hindi Pakwada. Then the need for national language is now the questions of whether or not India needs a national language can be justifiably answered. So India has managed to conduct its affair for the past more than 50 years with the many religious regional languages and 2 official languages. Then what we have achieved by way of linguistic unity is everyone now speak a common language, which when they came they could not, you know, like a Tamil who came did not know how to speak in Hindi, but nowadays of course he could learn. Okay, so the language has been evolved in such a manner that everyone speak. Things are moving gradually and people migrate, so something forced you to vote for linguistic unity. And you know, interesting here that economic now seem to have become the primary mechanism from spreading a common language. And the beauty of this is that it is a very non-invasive way for this to occur. It may not be fast, but it is not mandated and does not constitute a direct imposition on anyone. So they would learn such a language to increase their chances of employment, something most people would like to do for this. And it could simply given as an options for study and not to be required as some wishes has been done with it. But as per the Constitution of India say, there are few important years where you never ever forget as per the where Hindi language is concerned. Like in 1950, that Indian Constitution declared Hindi as an officially Indian language, Continuous use of English was also provided. However, its replacement by Hindi and local language was envisaged in 15 years. Then 1963, after 13 years, Official Language Act passed, which Parliament ensured the continuance of use of English for official purposes. Proposal of making an end of the use of English. The attempt resulted in, you know, protestations all over the country. Example, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, and of course. So thus the proposal was dropped in the period of in the year of 1964. Then again 1965, anti-Hindi agitation against Hindi as the officially language of India. And in after 2 years, 1967, amended act, free use of English until a resolution is made. 2002, 71st amendment passed and included Kokni, Manipuri, Nepali, Sindhi were added in the 8th schedule of the Indian Constitution. In 2004, 92nd amendment, which include Bodo, Dogri, Maithili, Santani languages, also become a scheduled language. But then where is English language in India? The place of that? India has a special role in India. English has a special role in India as it is the co-official language of the constitution. One can say that in India everybody speaks English. Well, or you know, badly, but they speak. The use of English in India began in the colonial times when it was the language of the political power. So the language of the Raj, you know, like, and the today English still carries great prestige and, you know, symbolize advancement in the eye of the Indians. Moreover, it is not far from the truth that English is actually the official language of India in the practical sense. It is the language of the government, the media, the educations, you know, and the light, and it also appears useful by reason of job opportunities, and a medium language in a country where people speak thousands of different languages. But in India, Hindi and English like a cooperation, you know, like when we consider like administration, language of administration. So in the administration, English and Hindi, it's a cooperation, because administrative documents are communication within the central government, maybe in either English or Hindi. Whereas the languages or the language of legislation, English and Hindi. Parliamentary businesses may be either Hindi or English, but authoritative texts, of course, of all laws are required to be in English. Nevertheless, there are people in India who do not speak any other languages than their mother tongue. Thus, the constitution gives them the right to be able to express themselves in their own languages to any agencies. So the languages or the language of judiciary is English. Proceeding of the Supreme Courts are required to be in English, isn't it? States in India can choose their own official language. That means they can select one or more, or more than one, out of their regional languages and make it as the language of governmental issues and education. The use of language is essential to any general set of laws. You know, administrator naturally use language to make laws, and the law should accommodate the definitive goal of disagreements regarding the impact of that utilization of language. Law is the efficient guideline of the existence of an area by norms treated as the binding the individuals and their organizations. A law is a standard that is essential for maintaining peace and order in the systematic form of society. And language is the rule-based system of sign used for communication. So the laws coded in language and legal concepts are accessible only through language. Like you can say, like interview a police officer, can cases in courts take place through the, you know, language? The relationship between the partners in contract is also taken care of by language. Law experts is controlled through language. Language works as a medium used to transmit the message from sender to receiver. Or one need a common ground for communication. So the English is known to be the wide sphere language utilized by the individual wherever on the world to convey and disappear words. Activities and sentiments on a worldwide and a worldwide scale. This language is educated in all school and colleges, even the university and nowadays everywhere, for preschool, schools, on a graduate level. This is a kind of language that is specialized in nature and has been utilized by exceptionally trustworthy men in a general public for a long time past. The greater part of the laws, resolutions, rules and the guidelines in different nations has been written in English. Thing is, the very pith of this development in globalization, where individuals from various nations speak with one another. Like advancement and upgraded in science and technology. Additionally, have had a colossal effect in the field of law. Information on the law does not end there on the ground that interaction of translation and correspondence of the law is important to transfer the significant elements of the law to help give arrangement and save lives. People with a lower level of education, children, you know, like dialect speaker, illiterate people, second language speakers, people who are deaf, you know, mute, and you know, people with the low IQ, people who have negative social attitudes and prejudice will be on the disadvantages side of the language in law. We can say it is not possible to understand very well, you know, like law also has a potential to be a mechanism of operation rather than a mean of achieving justice. But the acquiring legal language is not limited to learning a set of terms, but is also about learning a new way of thinking, entering into a different language and a different world. Agree that the legal languages can be more descriptive than conceptual and closer to ordinary language. More guidelines with reference to the linguistic aspects of creation and application of law should be formulated, you know, and some efforts directed toward the modernization of legal terms may not lead to an increase in their understandability. Because attempts should be made to increase understandability by focusing on the structure of legal text. Since individual from different nation as of now have the ability to meet others from different state, then it is significant that an individual is, you know, knowledgeable in the English language, since most people are English speakers. But law food technically, and the law really started in the British and American locates, which was later on duplicated and followed by, you know, other European and Asian nations. And consequently, the focal language utilized as a mode for correspondence and composing in English. As a paralegal and lawyer, maybe you will experience that customer and the individual coming from various nations, and similarly on the off chance that there is a requirement for a move of area, for instance of this case, one place to the another, in that point there is a colossal rates that the individual moving and will communicate with English speakers with the different persons. So subsequently, the law field should also adjust in the English language of the speaker, since it is utilization of the customary court or somewhere the hearing and the technique as well. But after 1950, when Indian adopted a new constitution and a federal state known as the Indian Union, a democratic Ray republic and member of the public commonwealth. So the Indian Constitution adopted in 1950 stipulated that English and Hindi would be used for the Union's official business for the period of 15 years, which mentioned in Article 343 in the Indian Constitution. After that time, Hindi was supposed to become the sole official language of the Union. It proved impossible to replace Hindi with English. However, because of strong opposition from the other areas where Dravidian language was spoken, they felt that the federal government was, you know, like trying to impose Hindi across the country, including the South, and preferred to continue using English, which they found more acceptable. Because unlike Hindi, it was not associated with any particular ethnic group. And later, the Official Language Act passed and legally established Hindi and English as the languages used in Congress, while leaving states and territory free to choose their own official language. Now, the languages, the provision in the Indian Constitution, after adopted the constitution 1950, like Article 29, protection of interest of minorities. Article 29 say that any sections of the citizen residing in the territory of India or any part thereof having a distinct language, script or culture or its own shall have the right to conserve the same. No citizen shall be denied admission into any educational institution maintaining by the state, or, you know, receiving aid out of state funds, ground, or etc. Or we can say for religion, race, caste, discrimination, anything. Even Article 15 also say the state shall not create discrimination on the ground of race, caste, sex, base. Discrimination on the basis of language is also there. Article 30 say right of minorities to establish and administer educational institution. And in this educational, they prefer their language because of their minority, isn't it? So the all minorities were based on religion or language shall have the right to establish and administer educational institution of their choice. Article 30 also, the state shall not, in granting aid to educational institution, discriminate against any educational institution on the ground that it is under the management of a minority, whether based on religion or language. This is specifically mentioned in this Article 13, Clause 2 in Indian Constitution. Article 120 says language to be used in Parliament. A complete chapter, like I think it's a part 17, if I'm not wrong. In this say that language to be used in Parliament, but subject to provision of Article 348, business in Parliament shall be translated in Hindi or in English. And provided that the chairman of the Council of States or the Speaker of the House of the People or person acting as such as the case may be, may permit any member who cannot adequately express himself in Hindi or in English to address the House in his mother tongue. So the unless Parliament by law otherwise provided this provision, after the expiry of period of 15 years from the commencement of the constitutions, have effect as if the words "or" in English were omitted therefrom. Article 120 says also that it is notwithstanding anything in part 17, but subject to the provision of Article 348 as well applicable. Article 343 says official language of the Union. Article 343 says the official language of the Union shall be Hindi in Devanagari script. The form of numeral to be used for the official purposes of the Union shall be the international form of Indian numerals. And provided that the President may, during this the said period, by order authorize the use of the Hindi language in addition to the English language and of the Devanagari form of numerals in addition to the international form of Indian numerals for any of the official purposes of the Union. But notwithstanding anything in this article 343, because Parliament may by law provide it for the use after the period of 15 years, and they say first is the English language and the second say the Devanagari form of numeral for such a purposes as may be specified in the law. Article 344 said that Commission and Committee of Parliament on an official language. A President shall at the expiration of 5 years from the commencement of the Constitution and thereafter at the expiration of 10 years from such commencement, by order constitute a commission which shall consist of a chairman and such other members representing the different languages specific in the 8th schedule, as I told earlier, 8th schedule, as the President may appoint, and the order shall define this, the procedure to be followed by the Commission. It shall be the duty of the Commission to make commencement, or you know, it is make a recommendation to the President as to the progressive use of the Hindi language for the official purpose of the Union, or restriction on the use of the English language for all or any of the official purposes of the Union, or the language to be used for all or any of the purposes mentioned in Article 348. Article 345 says official language or language of the state. So same it is applicable Article 346 and 347, because subject to the provision in this Article 345, Article 346 and 347, the legislature of the state may by law adopt any one or more of the languages in use of the state, or Hindi as a language, or languages to be used for all or any of the official purposes of that particular state, because it is related to state only, Article 345. But provided that the legislature of the state otherwise provides by law, the English language shall continue to be used for those official purposes within the state for which it was being used immediately before the commencement of the constitution. Article 346 also says the same, official language for communication between one state or another, or between a state or the union. Article 345 says special provision relating to the language spoken by a section of the population of a state. A complete chapter has given in the constitution, which is language of the Supreme Court and the High Court. Article 368, language to be used in Supreme Court and the High Court, or you know, like acts, for any acts, bill, etc. This is Article 348, where Article 349 says special procedure for enactment of certain laws relating to languages is also important. So this is the 343, the range is for regarding the languages only. Special directives also there, chapter 4 in Indian constitution, that Article 350 said that language to be used in the representations for redress of grievance. Every person shall be entitled to submit a representation for the redress of any grievance to any officer or you know authority of the union or the state, in any of the language used in the union or the state, whatever the case may be. Article 350 capital A say facilities for instruction in mother tongue at the primary state. Article 350 B says special officer for linguistic minorities. 351, which is directives for development of the Hindi language. Here is a mention, the development directives for the development of Hindi language. Because of this Article 351, central government organized you know like camp or something, like as I mentioned, Hindi Pakwada or Sahitya Sammelan, for you know that promote the spread for the Hindi language, to develop it so as that it may serve as the medium of expression for all the elements of the composite culture of India, and to secure its enrichment by assimilating without interfering with its genus and you know the form, style and expression used in Hindustani and in the other language of India, we specify in the 8th schedule, and by the drawing wherever necessary or desirable for its vocabulary, primary or Sanskrit, and of course the secondary or any other language. Where the linguistic right is concerned, so linguistic right are the human and civil rights concerning the individual and collective rights too. And we chose the language or languages for communication in a private or public atmosphere. So the other parameter for analyzing of this languages, like linguistic rights include the degree of territoriality or amount of possibility or maintenance of this language as well. So the linguistic rights include, amongst others, like the right to one own language in legal, administrative, judiciary, and language educations and media in the language understood and freely chosen by those concerned. And as far as the linguistic is concerned, there are the documents like Universal Declaration of Linguistic Right 1996, European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages 1992, the convention of the right of child, these all are the linguistics, you know, like the framework convention for the protection of national minorities, conventional against discrimination in education, international covenant on civil and political rights. But the guarantees, if we talk about the guarantees for linguistic minority in India, that is what the Indian Constitution say, Article 31. Article 31 say of the Indian Constitution, which provides a fundamental right to linguistic minority to establish and administer as education, which I explained earlier. Article 351, Article 350. In 1971, there is a case of DAV College versus State of Punjab. In this case, the Supreme Court of India defined a linguistic minority as a minority that at least has a spoken language regardless of having a script or not. So this is the one of the landmark judgment in 1971 by the Supreme Court. Even the TM Pai Foundation case is also say in Karnataka, state of Karnataka, that the status of linguistic minority is to be determined in the context of states and not India as a whole. The protection of linguistic minority, that's the commission. So according to the report of the National Commission for Religious and Linguistic Minority, they explain that the status of the community is determined by numerical inferiority, non-dominant status in the state and possessing a distinct identity. Report also stated that exclusive adherence to minority languages or the language is a leading factor that contributes to social economic backwardness, and that this backwardness can be addressed only by teaching the majority language. The commission should have rather emphasized the need to develop mechanism and institution structure to, you know, accommodate linguistic minority so that they do not fall into the trap of social economic backwardness, you know, like merely because of the language they speak. So instead of addressing the gap in the education system which makes invisible the language of the linguistic minorities, the commission recommends that such individuals and the communities learn the majority language to survive, you know, because this is the clear acknowledgement of systematic state discrimination emanating on the basis of the language that an individual and, you know, the community speak. The state is responsible to create equal opportunity for everyone regardless of whether they belong to the majority or, you know, or the minority, but it's clearly failed to do so. And in 2006, the National Commission for Religious and Linguistic Minorities lead to the recommendation that the term linguistics minority must be defined properly, and that such a definition should then be used while framing a law to provide affirmative action based on socioeconomic backwardness. Even though the criteria suggested for identifying socioeconomic backwardness among linguistic minorities is the same as that applied while identifying backward community in India. So to be regarded as more backward, the individual among the linguistic minority must not have the knowledge of the minority language. This is the problematic, you know, as the additional criteria for this determine the backwardness of the linguistic minority group should not be the lack of knowledge of majority language. Instead, it should be the vulnerability of the particular language to extinction. Lack of institutional support to develop, sustain, to promote a language. And when we talk the vulnerability, so always like institution of like scheduled caste, scheduled tribes are going to be affected. Because of that, a high level committee on socioeconomic health education status of tribals community in India has rightly pointed out that the, you know, for extremely low literacy rates among the particular, you know, like vulnerable tribal groups or poor educational infrastructures that are poorly trained teacher, you know, like it's affected the language. Actually, this is, of course, the therefore, like, you know, paying the path towards the real education of such students while also equipping them to resourcefulness is the second, the language. But in Indian Constitution, also explaining very detailed that part 17. Of official language regarding the discrimination and all that. For example, an employee may be experiencing language discrimination, and if the workplace has a speak English only policy, but her primary language is the one that other than English, so the person is never capable to job according to that clause. Because of that, Article 15C in Indian Constitution, that language discrimination occurs when a person is treated differently because of her native language and this category, state has to be protected. There are so many drafts, you know, like the first draft of the National Education Policy, the second, and that every time it's going to be improved somewhere. But the original draft has proposed that school children learn three languages, namely that is which I mentioned, English, Hindi, and optional whatever the mother tongue. Modern Indian language, in case their mother tongue is Hindi. So there is, like, even present status, if we say according to the Indian Constitution, as per the Indian Constitution, the 8th schedule, as the evolution of dialects and language is dynamic and influenced by the socio-economic political development, it is difficult to fix any criterion for languages, whether to distinction term from dialects or from inclusion in the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India. In 1996 and 2003, when the Pawa and the Mohapatra committee, which involves such fixed criteria, has not borne fruit, the government is concerned of the sentiment that requirement for inclusion of other language in the 8th schedule and so on. So the thing is, when the languages or for the rights are there, we have to follow 3 to 4 points. Is category, like, dignity is the first, you know, the first article of the UDHR declared that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and the rights, which is a fundamental principle, and rule of international law, especially important in issues surrounding protection of promotion of minority dignity, where liberty is private activity. But the language preference are protected by basic human rights, such as the freedom of expression, the right to private life, the right to minorities to use their own language, or to the prohibition of discrimination. Any private endeavors, whether commercial, artistic, religious, any, may be protected. Equality and non-discrimination. The prohibition of discrimination prevents a status from unreasonably disadvantage also is one of the important points for this, you know, like the discrimination, the law and language and the law is concerned. Identity, you know, the linguistic forms of identity, whether for individual, the communities, or the state, is a fundamental for many, or this too can at times be protected by the right to freedom of expression, the right to private life, and etc. So, beside all this, you know, the decisions or the case study or for the all the historical perspective of this language and the law, something is a here for the unique attributions for linguistic human rights, and which provides a framework of this the articles in Indian Constitution, which is dignity, liberty, equality, and the of course the identity in language matter. How to apply and implement the basic human rights which abridges to language so that a state may effectively comply with its international obligations. So with this, how I stop here. Thank you so much, all of you, and all the best for your examination. Bye.